Hello everybody, welcome to the webinar Virtual Rehabilitation, How Feedback and Motivation Influence Therapy Outcome. Today we have two guest speakers, two experts from the field in terms of research and clinical applications, which will give you an insight into the usage and the application and integration of virtual reality into your daily clinical routine. Keep also in mind, you can ask questions all the time using the chat function to address to our guest speakers and to me, and we will try to answer those questions at the end in the question answer expert panel session. So, now let's start.
Moving from the motion analysis lab, where we captured some sequences in advance, to the webinar studio, I would like to welcome you to the webinar Virtual Rehabilitation, How Feedback and Motivation Influence the Therapy Outcome. As a note, I will be talking about augmented feedback and virtual reality as virtual rehabilitation throughout this webinar. As already mentioned in the short introduction sequence, today we want to give you insights into the application and integration of virtual rehabilitation, primarily through two experts in this field, sharing their experience and knowledge with you. As we know, treating patients based on their cognitive or motor abilities requires always different approaches and individual rehabilitation techniques. But research shows that some key factors, as a combination, influence heavily the success of recovery and therefore the independency of each patient. For neurological and neuromuscular patients, key factors for successful recovery are, among others, motivation and engagement, feedback on various performance measures for both patient and therapist, and having to do movement tasks in a varied, dynamic, and interactive environment. For sure, often motivation and feedback have a direct or indirect impact on other key factors, like intensity or shaping. If we take a closer look at motivation and feedback in clinical rehabilitation from motor learning point of view, we see that there are factors affecting motor learning and influencing motivation. Relearning motor function with a specific goal improves performance as compared to simply doing your best. And even more important, the relearned motor function is retained. Patients can be discouraged by goals that are too hard, and goals that are too easy can result in boredom, reduced motivation, and thereby limit involvement in the exercises. Positive feedback on performance using virtual rehabilitation clearly affects motor learning in a positive way. Furthermore, self-regulation of practice, which can be reached using virtual rehabilitation, seems to lead to improved learning. And an added purpose occupation undoubtedly has a positive impact on learning. It has been shown that purposeful activity increases motivation and elicits maximum performance adaptation. And how can feedback enhance learning? It can assist with determining the nature of the error, which improves performance of subsequent movements and therefore relearning of the movements. Furthermore, feedback makes tasks more interesting and enjoyable in order to keep the patient alert, and it increases his effort, which has a positive impact on the number of repetitions. Augmented feedback also accelerates skill acquisition, promotes more efficient movements, and encourages learning. Intrinsic feedback mechanisms are often impaired or too complex, and so augmented feedback is of great importance for motor learning. Basically, a major component of motor optimization is the availability of feedback or the knowledge of results. But what do we know from literature and research about virtual rehabilitation? What are the key benefits? Virtual rehabilitation increases self-confidence and motivation. Furthermore, it enhances the motivation to practice, which may lead to more practice repetitions. And we have already addressed how important motivation is for motor learning. Further benefits of virtual rehabilitation are to record and analyze performance outcomes, to progress difficulty and challenge levels, and to provide enhanced real-time feedback about task performance or task results, which are beneficially for learning. It also supports cognitive rehabilitation and virtual rehabilitation environments, stimulate neuroplastic changes, and enhance learning effects. Virtual rehabilitation provides a safe environment to undertake tasks which may be difficult or unsafe in real life. Virtual rehabilitation also allows for repetitive and consistent practice of the same tasks. And there's a big potential for tele-rehabilitation, which may enable the physical therapist to stay at the clinic and the patient to stay at home. So according to Weiss and colleagues, virtual rehabilitation typically refers to the use of interactive stimulations created with computer hardware and software. These virtual rehabilitation setups can present users with opportunities to engage in environments that appear to be and feel similar to real-world objects and events. In order to give you a better understanding of what virtual reality in a clinical setting could look like, I want to show the basic principles through a short live demonstration. Basically, we combine a user input tracking device, like the sensor, with a display. And so I would like to welcome my colleague, David. Hello, David. How are you?
I'm good. And hi, Clemens. Thank you very much for inviting me to this nice webinar studio.
Great to have you here for this short live demonstration to show how virtual rehabilitation could look like. So you have already a sensor on your chest, which is connected with a belt.
That's right.
For sure, there are also other options to attach sensors. Maybe it could be also integrated into some clothes. We have also a sensor now with a sticker, which we place on the upper arm, so which reflects the upper arm. The sensor on the chest, of course, reflects the body, the trunk. There's also the opportunity for the adjustments to connect it by himself. So this, you can see how easily sensors could be adjusted to a patient or to a user itself. Now we would like to connect those sensors with the software, and therefore I would like to start a simple exercise where David has to do and to move now according to his motor abilities. So in this case, he has to calibrate the sensors, and now he is controlling the avatar with his movement, bringing the key to the treasure chest. And as you can see, in terms of engaging and increasing the motivation, there are different levels of challenging, so it's getting more and more difficult for the performance. So that's a simple example how virtual rehabilitation could look like, the connection between sensors and a software, a display, where David, in this example now, has to move and to fulfill some movement tasks. For example, in this case, it is motor coordination, so he has to follow a specific path in terms of the direction, in terms of the correctness of the movement, but also in terms of later time. So to show also maybe another approach is the same exercise with a higher difficulty level, really to see that it's also possible to adjust the difficulty level according to the motor abilities of the patient and also the cognitive abilities of the patient. It's getting much more challenging for him. He needs to be much more correct in his movement because the whole environment changed. So the path is much, much smaller compared to on lower levels. So that's an easy example also how we can address shaping and also to increase the intensity during a rehabilitation phase. I also would like to show you an additional example where David has to move in a 2D environment, has to collect some balloons, and also to do as much repetitions as possible, detecting the movement by the sensors. First the calibration again, and then in this case, collecting balloons, avoiding the bombs, so also a higher difficulty level. You see how motivated and engaged David is, how he's really performing with a lot of repetitions, using the whole range of motion, and this is really great. So that's a short example how this could look like. So, David, thank you very much for this introduction and this live demonstration to our audience and to us in the webinar. It was really good to have you here.
Thank you very much, Clemens. It was a pleasure.
As a first guest speaker, it is now my pleasure to introduce Professor John Krakauer, a leading expert in the field of virtual rehabilitation from Johns Hopkins University in Baltimore, Maryland, USA. His research focus is in general the area of experimental and computational motor control, with a particular focus on how motor learning occurs in the brain and how such learning is affected by lesions. In the Brain Learning Animation and Movement Laboratory, he is working with his team and others on the development of interventions early after stroke that combines immersive gaming environments with 3D exoskeletal robotics and non-invasive brain stimulation. So, welcome, Dr. Professor Krakauer. It's really good to have you here. Hope you're doing good.
Yes, thank you very much.
So, as we already mentioned in this webinar, that feedback and motivations are really some key factors for successful recovery. Can you explain me a little bit, or also our audience, why that is? So what's the reason behind from your experience, and how can we improve such factors to get also a better outcome at the end?
Yeah, so I think motivation has a number of meanings. It has a colloquial meaning, and then it has more of a scientific meaning. So I'll start with the colloquial one. I think a lot of people find rehabilitation boring. You know, it's you're sick, you're in the hospital, and you have to do exercises which quickly, you know, get dull, and they remind you of your deficit. So in other words, you're just super aware of what is wrong with you. So you need to find a way to make people enjoy their illness, which sounds like a contradiction, but that's what you really want, is for them to really want to partake in exercise. I mean, think about it. In the United States, they estimate that 40% of people who pay for their gym memberships never go to the gym.
Yeah, right.
So they're basically
like
subsidizing.
Me.
Yes. So imagine, and the idea that because you're sick, you're going to be more interested in exercising and doing your rehabilitation than a healthy person is not true.
Okay.
Right? That people stop doing their rehabilitation and they're not that interested. So in other words, you need to find a way to make the rehabilitation interesting so that people spend the amount of time needed on the task. We call that time on task, right?
So that's
one idea.
Mm-hmm. So it's like this enriched environment, right?
Well, that's different. So in other words, yes. In other words, the enrichment came from the animal literature, right? Which mm-hmm. was, you gave rats companions, you gave them slides and ramps and balls and tubes and wheels,
yep.
And that enhanced brain plasticity in a general way. So you're absolutely right. The question is, why don't we do enrichment for humans the way we know it works for animals? So that's, and the other idea about motivation is, we know that reward and knowledge increase learning rates. In other words, fundamentally, we don't know the exact mechanisms, but the speed-accuracy trade-off of movements is enhanced by reward and motivation.
Mm-hmm.
So in other words, there's the colloquial notion that you spend more time doing the exercise, and then there's the more scientific notion that motivation and reward actually multiply on motor learning mechanisms.
Okay.
And those are kind of separate ideas, but they come together in a motivating environment.
Okay, so what could be then an example, for example, to increase such scenarios with rewarding and enriched environments in terms of virtual rehabilitation? So is this possible through exercises then in a virtual world? So is this also what you experience?
Right. So I think it's important to not just automatically assume that virtual reality is the answer.
Yes.
Right? In other words, after all, if you are bored doing your exercises and your rehabilitation in the real world, you're going to be just as bored doing it in the virtual world.
Okay.
So in other words, you have to find new things to do in the virtual world that you couldn't do in the real world. Okay. So in other words, the basic idea behind virtual reality is that it provides a controlled, safe environment to have experiences that you couldn't possibly have as a patient in the real world. So for example, maybe a patient wants to skydive.
Yeah.
Right? We're not going to take a patient after stroke and take them skydiving. We're not going to take them surfing. So in other words, you have to try and find a way to take your rehabilitation experience and place it in a context that makes it 10, 100 times more exciting and motivating. And that's what virtual reality allows. It allows you to control feedback. It allows you to create experiences that are dangerous in the real world, but just exciting and safe in the virtual world. But all of that requires that the primary behavioral experience has been well thought out. Okay, and so let me say again, what you don't want to do is to take the regular form of rehab and simply dress it up in the virtual reality, because if the core experience is not good, all the excitement in virtual reality isn't going to change that.
Okay, so but that leads also maybe to a short video clip, which we also have from one of your projects you're also currently working on. So maybe during the clip, which we now play, maybe can you explain the audience what we are seeing and what is the application goal and how this could be integrated into a daily clinical routine?
Yes, absolutely. So this is the screen that patients currently see in a trial that we're doing with a game. Plus, of course, as you know, this is the Hokama Ameo Power. And this idea is that you want the patients to make large numbers of movements supported by the robot early after stroke. In other words, we want them to make hundreds, if not thousands, of exploratory movements. In fact, we are now having the patients cover about a kilometer to 2 kilometers per session. So what your goal is to be the dolphin. The dolphin's name is Bandit. And you have to catch fish, you need to swim, you need to jump. And as you get better, the challenges get more difficult until you have to battle with sharks. So it is a very immersive, exploratory, playful, motivating environment that is so exciting to the patients that they don't realize that they're doing, as I said, kilometers of arm movements every single day, which, by the way, is several orders of magnitude more than happens in a regular therapy session.
Absolutely. I think that's also one of the major goals, right, with motivation then to increase the number of repetitions, really to get more activity in the motor cortex for a better outcome. I think that's the final goal.
Yeah. I mean, just to reiterate, if you're going to use games and virtual reality and augmented reality, you have to come up with new ideas about the experience you have in those realities. Do you see what I'm saying? I mean, it's very important not to think that they are a way to avoid the difficult job of finding new rehabilitative experiences that exploit these new digital environments. And that's what we try to do here, is how can we use robotics and gaming to change the experience patients have?
Okay, and where do you see the future in rehabilitation, especially which role does virtual rehabilitation, virtual reality, augmented feedback, which role does they play in the future?
Well, I mean, I think that the major role will be that presumably they'll be applicable across the many different care environments. So mm-hmm. in the rehabilitation wards in the hospital, in the clinics, at home. So I think what these are beginning to allow is a continuum of care, which we haven't had before. And also it will allow you to customize the experience per patient, right? So one patient, as I said, might want to be a dolphin. Another patient might want to be a skydiver. So I think it allows both increased intensity and dose of experience across the continuum of care, and it allows customization. So I think it's the beginning of a new world for neurorehabilitation.
So that would also mean the whole structure of rehabilitation and neurorehabilitation needs to be also adjusted in the next years, right? So it's like...
Absolutely. I mean, this is going to be not just an addition to the current way that we do things. It will change qualitatively the way we do things. Absolutely. Okay.
But what does this also mean for education purposes of physical therapists, like in PT schools, universities? So I assume they should also get much more information about this to be really also an expert applying and integrating such really interesting tools then at the end. Is this correct?
Yeah,
is it education-wise, but also the whole structure in the clinic, there's, let's say, also space for improvements then in the future?
Oh, completely. I mean, I think it's going to... The type of education that people get as therapists will change completely. You'll have to learn how to code. You're going to have to learn how to maybe game. You're going to have to get aesthetics. You're going to have to learn about story. I mean, it's going to be a very different educational experience going forward. No question in my mind. And you know, there's always this interplay between ideas and the new technologies,
right?
And that's and the technologies change your ideas, and your ideas change the technology. So it's going to completely change the landscape.
And so, but on the other side, there is still, let's say, some skepticism about virtual reality and virtual rehabilitation, and some healthcare professionals still call it like simply gaming. So how would you counter these statements? So from your perspective, from your experience.
Okay, so first of all, I am sympathetic to the automatic belief that new technology will solve all our problems, right? In mm-hmm. other words, that's, some people have referred to that as solutionism, the idea that a clean new technology will come along and save us. In fact, there are some people in the United States, for example, who think we don't have to worry about global warming because a technology is around the corner that will solve our problem, right? So this worship of technology is a problem. It's a kind of religious belief. Okay, so we have to be careful about that. On the other hand, to call something just a game, I mean, I'm sure these people who are critical spend an incredible amount of time watching sports on television and playing sport. And so what they should ask themselves is, why are we so fascinated by sport? And sport is really just the mixture of challenge and movement. So obviously, if we could come up with the equivalent of sport for patients, we should. A game is basically a way of making people stay on task. Now, if they believe that their current methods are having the patients do enough therapy, I mean, in the United States, you do 1 hour of OT, 1 hour of PT, and 1 hour of speech every day. That's mm-hmm. 3 hours out of 24 hours.
That's
now
little.
Why? Not very much, right? So, and if you ask them, what about if the patients were to do 6 to 8 hours a day? Well, they'll say they'll get tired, they'll get bored, they'll get fatigued. But actually, that's not true. If there was something interesting enough for them to do, they would do it. So they have to explain to us how they expect us to have patients do 6 to 8 hours a day of therapy, which the data are beginning to suggest helps.
Yeah.
And I cannot see how we're going to be able to do that much therapy without using technology.
Okay, so that's like also to increase a little bit the efficiency of the settings, right? To offer more therapy, to integrate technology. And if I get it correctly, such exercises which are playable in virtual reality may help, especially in terms of the motivation to really to do this 6 to 8 hours per day with a long-term story, with really things you would also like to do, right? That's a little bit also your message.
Yeah, I mean, there was a paper published in the last couple of years where they were giving patients 5 hours a day of therapy. It wasn't virtual reality. And they did 50 to 60 sessions, 5 hours a day. That's a lot more than anything that's done currently. But that required one therapist for every 3 patients to realistically give that much therapy. So it's almost obvious that you're going to be able to use technology so that one therapist, I mean, we need the therapists, mm-hmm. can actually help more than one person at a time. Okay. Right. So you can see what can happen if you merge technology with people. You can amplify the efficiency.
Okay. So great. Thanks for the first input, Professor John Krakauer. The audience will still have the chance to ask some questions through the chat function. We will see us later in the expert panel session, the question and answer round, so where they can also address directly questions to you. Thanks you for the first time.
My
for
pleasure.
The input, and see you later.
Okay, bye-bye.
So now I'm also very glad we have the chance to talk about virtual rehabilitation with an experienced physiotherapist. Maarten has almost 10 years of experience with virtual reality in one of the bigger rehabilitation hospitals in the Netherlands. Hello, Maarten. Thank you for joining as a guest speaker. Hope you can hear us, and welcome to the webinar. Hello.
Hello, hi. Thank you.
So how are you doing?
I'm good, thank you. Weather is a bit cold in the Netherlands, but I'm excited to be in the webinar.
Great. Good to have you here. So first of all, maybe you could give us a quick overview how you integrate and apply virtual reality or the whole virtual rehabilitation field in your clinical setting. So what are you doing currently in the Netherlands?
So I work at a rehabilitation center, and at this rehabilitation center we have several therapy departments. We have a physiotherapy department, a psychology department, but we have a separate virtual reality department as well. And at this virtual reality department we have 3 virtual reality systems. And patients can train on these systems. And mm-hmm. during treatment sessions, a patient either sits or stands or walks on a movable platform. And while they are doing exercises, they are surrounded by a screen on which we can project a virtual environment. And they can interact with this virtual environment by making movements of their body. I am full-time employed at this VR rehabilitation department, and more or less 50% of my work is therapy-related and 50% of my work is research-related.
That sounds really interesting. So, but what was the reason for you or also for your team and your clinic to decide to implement such virtual rehabilitation technologies? And what did you consider before the implementation? Were there something specifically where you thought, okay, we have to think about this, this, and this? So can you give us some inputs?
Yeah, we started to implement virtual reality into our rehabilitation center in 2008. Mm-hmm. And we especially had to consider how to find our place between all the other therapies, because all the other therapies were already there and we were new in the scene. And at the same time, we had to figure out how to use virtual reality to add value to the rehabilitation progress of our patients. And what we did is we started to collaborate with several therapies to make new applications for our systems, to adjust existing applications, and to write new protocols. And by working together with other therapies, because VR is not a therapy on its own, but rather a tool to provide therapy, we could learn a lot from these physiotherapists and psychologists, and they really helped us improve our therapy. And at the same time, because they could see where we could add value into the rehabilitation progress, we deserved our spot within the rehabilitation center.
Great. So now it's, I assume, well accepted. So could you also give us an insight how often a patient will get such treatment, or how often such systems are running per day?
Yeah, so of the three systems we have, we see 70% of the day we see patients on these systems, and the other time is used for research and development. Yep. And our patients get treatment sessions of 30 minutes, like in the other therapies, and patients generally visit us for 10 to 15 sessions of half an hour, and they generally get two sessions a week. So we see them for 5, 6, 7 weeks in a row.
Okay, and do you see differences between different patient pathologies, or are there, can you say that some pathologies or some patients benefit much more from such a type of treatment, VR technology treatment? Is there something what you can say based on your experience?
Yeah. Obviously, we see differences between patients, just like physiotherapy is very different for a stroke patient compared to a patient with knee pain. And what we just try to figure out in each patient is where can we add value over the other therapies. For example, if you look at coordination training, it's easier, in my opinion, to provide coordination training for the legs and the arms using general therapy, because you can make someone hop on one leg through an obstacle course, or you can make him throw a ball towards a target. But the coordination of the trunk of spine movements is very hard to provide feedback on,
right,
using conventional therapy. And we wanted to improve the coordination of the trunk in low back pain patients. And we can do that using virtual reality, because we can measure the angles of the trunk using the sensors you showed at the beginning of the webinar. And we make patients play a game where they can control the movements of an airplane, for instance, by just moving their trunk left, right, forward and backward. And it, because it's so motivating, you can make them do this coordination exercise for 20 minutes in a row, and it doesn't get dull. And at the same time, you are training their trunk coordination. So if they have to make movements into their in their daily lives, you lower the risk of them injuring their back again.
Okay, so you already mentioned some improvements after such treatments, like focusing a little bit on coordination, and also to reduce additional risks in daily life. But what else could be, or what other improvements do you see with your patients? Are there anything else, like increasing some capacities, getting better in different muscle strength, whatever? So what do you recognize?
Well, for me, a very surprising advantage of virtual reality was that patients tend to forget their own impairments when they are in a virtual reality environment. So what we often do is that we make a video recording of our patients while they are doing exercises on our systems. And that can have very surprising results for the patients, because for example, some patients can be too cautious. If you have an amputee who has a new prosthesis, he can be very cautious because he's afraid to fall. And sometimes they don't go out of the house. They don't go do the things they like shopping or visiting friends. And if we show them what they are actually capable of doing just by showing the video of themselves exercising in a virtual environment, sometimes they're very surprised and get more confidence, so they dare to do more in their daily lives. And on the other side of the spectrum, we see patients as well that are too confident. They think they can do anything, and all the doctors and therapists are holding them back, and they really don't like that. And if we train them in a virtual environment, sometimes they fall 4 or 5 times during a therapy session. That's not a big deal because they are attached using a safety harness, so when they fall, they will not fall on the ground. But it gives them extra insight that they might need to be more cautious in their daily life because they could fall and injure themselves.
Okay. So to summarize this a little bit, what are for you the main benefits and what are the main challenges so far using virtual rehabilitation in a clinical setting? What out of your experience?
Well, in my opinion, the main benefit of virtual reality is that you can do anything, because it's just a tool. You can use it for any type of therapy. So you can make a patient do any exercise you want. You can provide any feedback you like, and you can put them in new environments as well. And patients really think it's challenging. So you have that motivational aspect, but you can also provide new types of therapy. For instance, if you make someone exercise in an environment with a lot of snow and ice, this can have a reducing effect on pain. But all these possibilities of virtual reality can be a challenge as well, because you really have to start doing it. Some people are very hesitant to start using virtual reality because they have no idea where to begin. And at the moment, there is no school or university where you can learn to be a virtual reality therapist or doctor. But in our experience, you just have to start doing it and just observe your patient and talk with other disciplines. And by doing it, you will start seeing where you can improve existing applications, or you might get ideas to create new applications. There's a whole world out there to discover. I mean, the dolphin application is a very good example of what you can do, but the possibilities are endless.
Okay, so you see still a lot of potential also in the future for virtual rehabilitation. So thanks, Maarten, also for your input for the beginning. I would like now to summarize a little bit what we have learned today, and to give there a little bit a more, let's say, a conclusion about the whole principles behind. So we've also prepared some video clips where we now show different types of technologies, different examples, and where you can also see how virtual reality, virtual rehabilitation is integrated and applied. So if we summarize what we have learned, it's like that virtual rehabilitation really offers a realistic and safe and also a motivational setting in which also complex activities can be practiced. So here you can see augmented feedback really for the upper extremity with a lot of repetitions, also in a group setting or parallel setting. Motor rehabilitation should also be focused really on functional movements, like you can see here, in a relevant environment, especially with a high intensity, a large number of repetition, as we have learned, as also Professor John Krakauer mentioned. And for sure, really an appropriate feedback, so that feedback for the patient as well as for the therapist. And when a patient concentrates really on the game rather than their impairment, exercises become more enjoyable, motivating, and more likely to be sustained over the many trials needed to induce neuroplastic changes. So also here as an example, as you have seen on the treadmill, now it's really like a robotic assisted system, like here the Locomat, where you have an augmented performance feedback. For both, again, for the patient as well as for the therapist, really seeing the ability of the patient. And that's really the core concept, really like for lower extremities, upper extremities, for the whole body, as we have heard, really also in different phases in the rehabilitation, really at the end phase, maybe also for the home market, for outpatient settings, inpatient settings, for orthopedic, for patients, for neurological patients. So there are a lot of application areas where we can address virtual rehabilitation with different functions. So this is what we have learned, and maybe which also was seen now in this short video clip with different opportunities, with different technologies, really in a wide, wide range. So now I would like to open the question and answer session, the expert panel, with our two guest speakers. So let's see which questions already came in. And there are some questions all over the world. Maybe some questions for Professor John Krakauer. So hello again, Professor John Krakauer. So at the moment there is
it has my it has the wrong name under my photo.
Yes, I see. So I'm asking the technician to change the name under your profile, right? Yes. So now it should be correct. So there's a question from Michael Ortiz. Hi everyone. No doubt, virtual reality opens up entirely new option in neurorehabilitation. But can you always correlate the patient's improvements in virtual reality to real life improvements? I think there's the question, you know, to doing the transfer of doing things in virtual reality into daily life. What is your comment? What is your experience?
Well, it's a strictly empirical question. I mean, it's the two questions that you always have to ask when it comes to neurorehabilitation are: does what you've learned get retained? In other words, do you remember it? And does it generalize? And those are not asked that much in neurorehabilitation, so it's a great question. It's an empirical question. We just don't have enough data to know the answer to that. My guess is that you probably will, but that will depend entirely on empirical data. But I don't think that one should assume that because it's in virtual reality, it will therefore not generalize to reality. I don't think that should be such a strong null hypothesis that we don't try.
And for example, of course, you could also combine both, right? So also in a virtual reality environment, you could also use some real obstacles to combine things, which also then gives an additional value also for daily life. That's also an option. As you mentioned, there's a broad, a wide range using virtual reality.
Yeah, and we would call that augmented reality,
yes.
Right? In other words, I think that it's, you know, to strictly speaking, virtual reality is when you're entirely immersed in a virtual world. But what you're referring to is augmented reality, which,
yes.
You know, for example, the Microsoft HoloLens is exactly that. It projects virtual objects into the real world. So you're right. All kinds of mixtures could be tried.
Okay. So maybe let's see if there are some other questions. There's plenty of questions. There's a question, 2D versus 3D animations from a clinical application perspective. Also, according to your experience, when do you apply one or the other in neurological rehabilitation? So is it a criteria depending on the severity of impairment to select a 1D, 2D, 3D environment, or what would you argue?
Are you asking about the what you do or what you see? I mean, I think
what you do. I know what you see on the in either augmented feedback or on the virtual reality. So if this has
again, it's an empirical question, right? In other words, everyone thought that people would love 3D cinema over 2D cinema,
right?
and it's not turned out to be true. So I think it's much more about the movements that the imagery inspires you to make.
Mm-hmm.
I don't think that there's anything to suggest yet that that's going to be what determines how well you do. It's going to be what you actually do. I mean, for example, in our game, it's 2D.
Yep.
Do I believe that people would like it more in 3D? Maybe. But in the end, it's about the movements that you make with your body and what you're inspired to do, rather than some fundamental difference between 3 and 2D, in my view.
Okay, an additional question from Svetlana. What can you tell about using more immersive technology like Oculus Rift to increase even more the effects of VR in therapy? So do you have any experience using some classes or Googles like including virtual reality? Or what's your opinion about this?
Well, we've started to try and to play with the Oculus and with Vive.
Mm-hmm.
Again, you want to make sure that people don't get cyber sickness, which they're beginning to deal with. But again, I really think I have to make a very important point here. You mustn't have a technology and then think what you can do with it. You need to have a biological principle or mm-hmm. a wish to treat a patient. And then you say to yourself, oh, this question, this biological hypothesis would be best addressed if this technology existed. Do you see what I'm saying?
Yeah.
You have to have a question first and then think that virtual reality, I mean, all virtual reality relies on goggles like that, unless you're in a cave, right? But you need to ask it the other way around. What do I want to give the patient that I couldn't give them if I didn't have virtual reality?
Okay.
Right.
So
not that I have the Oculus Rift. What am I going to do with it?
Okay. So based on the therapy goal and the needs of the patient and what you would like to do, then to use this really as a great tool to get much more out at the end. Right. Great. So maybe we would also like to include now Maarten as a speaker for the question answer. Maybe there are also some questions from the audience for Maarten. So let's see which questions we should select. There's a question for Maarten. Maarten, can you hear us?
Yes, I can hear you loud and clear.
Great. So there's a question. You mentioned that the possibility with VR are endless, and at the same time, you're still exploring new treatment methods. How is the science moving forward, and are you implementing scientific results as far as VR research is concerned in your treatment methods, and how? So could you give us a little bit more insight about, let's say, more the research part?
Yes, of course. So we had a PhD project which we were involved in about gait adaptability. This was a research done by Laura Hack, and she investigated if stroke patients are capable of making these step adjustments that I was talking about, so decreasing your step length, increasing your step length, and, mm-hmm. and she found out that they are not capable of doing that to the extent where healthy subjects can. And as a result of that research, we were involved in creating new applications to train this walking adaptability. But we are also involved in the treatment of post-traumatic stress disorder.
Mm-hmm.
There's a very known therapy for patients who have post-traumatic stress, where they need to move their eyes from left to right while they are feeling very anxious. And what we know from that therapy is that it works best if patients have maximal anxiety levels during mm-hmm. the desensitizing stimulus. And if you use virtual reality, because it's so immersive, it's easier to get higher levels of anxiety because if someone is traumatized by a war, for instance, you can really place him back to the scene where he got his trauma in the first place. And in that way, we can use virtual reality to provide new types of therapy. And there are two research projects being done now as well to compare this VR rapid eye movement desensitization therapy to the regular type.
Okay, so that was now about the research. So going a little bit back to the application. So we have a question from Dimitrios. What is the maximal hours virtual reality training for the patient in each week? So is there a limit? So where you can say, okay, that's really the maximum and how much we pressure the patient. So I think the question is getting more, it's also a little bit on the one side, Professor Krakauer also mentioned the cyber sickness as a could be a limitations for the virtual classes. But is there some limit where you can say only a maximum hours are applicable for such kind of patients, or what is your experience?
Yeah, well, obviously it depends on your patients, and it depends on the type of therapy you provide. I've said it before, the virtual reality is just a tool, and you can provide psychology therapy, physiotherapy, any kind of therapy you like using these systems. And it depends how intense you make these exercises, how many hours patients can do them. But I'm convinced that you could start a rehabilitation center where you only use virtual reality for your patients, and you would be able to offer the same amount of therapy hours or even more than in conventional rehabilitation center. The big question is, do you want it? I don't think so, because I think it's still very important to exercise in the normal world as well, because that is where you need to incorporate all the tricks you have learned during therapy.
So it's at the end, it's a combination, right? It's a combination of a VR training and a combination also on such conventional things, really also then to train the transfer also in the daily life. That's what,
definitely. Yeah.
So we have also an additional question from Vena. Do you use any standard presents or other questionnaire to assess the progress of the patients during or after the training? So what is done in your facility in the Netherlands? How do you progress the training? And I think then the next question would be also, how do you adjust then the treatment according to the assessment? So can you explain us a little bit?
Yeah, we are a multidisciplinary center, so patients always have other therapies as well. Yep. And it would be a bit strange for us to make them fill out a lot of questionnaires, because they can do that at all the other sites as well. So we try to gather information using our systems. So we have developed several tests for our patients. For example, we have developed a stability test for knee and ankle patients, where we perturb these patients while they are standing on one leg. And then we measure the reaction to come to a score of their stability, because stability is very often in these patients not impaired when you measure it static. But when you measure it dynamic, so in reaction to a perturbation, you do see differences. Yeah. And the scores of these tests have an effect on the therapy, because what we often see is, if we have a patient with knee problems, is that their injured leg is scoring a lot worse than their non-injured leg. But sometimes both their legs score very poorly. And if we see that could be a reason to put a lot of effort in their uninjured leg as well, because we don't want them to injure that leg after they have injured their other leg. And we also communicate these findings to the other therapies so that they can benefit from these measurements as well.
Okay, so it's also like an interdisciplinary team exchanging experience and findings with the patient. We have also a question about the application of virtual rehabilitation. So do you also use this with severely cognitive impaired patient? Is this also in one patient population you use virtual rehabilitation? So it's
there we also often see a lot of added value of virtual reality, because some stroke patients, they are not capable of speaking anymore because that part of their brain is injured, and that often makes it very difficult for a therapist to keep on making them do different things during therapy, because there's a lot of communication involved normally. But when you give feedback on movements, patients just can experience what happens if they make several movements, and we often don't even have to explain what they need to do. You just put them on the system, place the sensors where you need to place them, press play, and then the first 1 or 2 minutes are often a disaster because they have no idea what they're doing, but they are just figuring it out themselves. And that's also the fun thing of that kind of feedback, is they can do it themselves. You don't need a therapist there pointing, no, you need to do that with your elbow, that with your wrist, because they can discover it themselves. Yep. And it's just a case of designing the games right, that they start doing the movements you want them to make.
Okay. So it's like also like an arrow-based learning through the feedback of VR,
yes,
really to learn again such functions, if it's walking or other things. So thank you very much, Maarten, for your input. I think we're also now running out of time. It's was really a pleasure to have you at the webinar. Also thanks to Professor John Krakauer to join the webinar. If there were some questions which were not already answered, we are trying to do this afterwards directly. So really thanks to both guest speakers joining the webinar, also giving us more insight into the virtual rehabilitation world in terms of application integration. On the one side, the usage, the application, on the other side, also in the research field. So I think it was really, really beneficial. I would also like to highlight the content of the next webinar, which we address in a couple of weeks and months. I hope to see you again for the sensor-based technology meets physical therapy webinar with really two experienced guest speakers, Professor Andreas Luft and Professor Annick Timmermans, joining us also through Skype, really to give us more insights into this really interesting field. So thanks for joining the webinar. I wish you really a pleasant day. See you soon. Bye-bye.